Okay, good afternoon. Why don't we get started? Who did not attend the class yesterday? I just want to, can you raise your hands high? Okay, that's helpful because it helps me determine how much of class one I will repeat. Today I want to go quickly over what I taught you yesterday, kind of summarizing, and get into class two. But I also want to be explaining the same things I told yesterday. So MAE 165 and 265 gets together three times a week. And some error was made. The undergraduates knew that, but the graduates didn't know that. Okay, so that's one point. Also, both the undergraduate and graduate were very oversubscribed. And so we are trying to see today how this works out. So I hope, to be honest, not many more people show up because again, we would have to go to a bigger classroom. And I rather actually would like to keep it like this now because as you know, at least those students that were there yesterday, we will do practica. And this practica, with the more people you get less hands-on. So that's a little bit a difficulty. We have to split you guys in groups to be able to at least have some hands-on experience, right? So, I also told you the materials that I'm presenting you will find on the website biomems.net. Actually, if you go there now and you look under classes, you will already find materials, but they are those of last year. So be patient, don't print it out yet. If you did, well, it's okay, but the syllabus is, it's okay. It won't, you see, it will be a good exercise for you to adapt, write a little changes, huh? Because on the syllabus I changed that a little bit, there will be, each class will be modified a little bit, it will be okay. It won't be that much difference, okay? This class is a little bit cooler than the other one, so that's an advantage. Yesterday, for those people that were not there, we were in a class of probably for 30 students and had about 48 students, so that was pretty tough. And to compensate for your pains, I will kind of summarize what we covered yesterday, and that also helps students that were not there yesterday. So, are we on board? So the class is called Advanced Manufacturing Choices. What I did not dwell upon enough was that in terms of grading, it will go as follows. Final exam will be 40% of your grade, midterm 30%, and then lab and class activities together will account for 30%. Being in the class is very important. Because there's so much movies that we will show, there's hands-on, and if you haven't been there, you will probably miss things in the final and the midterm. So I have to warn you about that. And so in a way, that's captured. Class activity might mean just being there, right? Good. For those people that were not here yesterday, the practica we will do are as follows. There will be one class about CNC machining, and you remember what CNC machining stood for, right?
Right, computer, numerical.
Numerical, good, good. Control, right. And so you guys will go all the way from a shape to computer-aided design drawing to computer-aided manufacturing to make a part. Because that machine is complicated and I don't want you guys to lose any fingers. And so in that case, you will be witnessing the process. You will explain how it works and you'll see how a CNC machine part is made. The next class that you will actually make parts is soft lithography. It's kind of a neat new technique to make fluidic parts, mostly for prototyping. And that you will have hands on. The third one is kind of an easy one. It's a visit of the clean room. And why are we doing that? Well, I'm going to be talking about dry etching, plasmas, chemical vapor deposition, physical vapor deposition. And if you have no idea how that machinery looks like, it's kind of odd, right? So at least, and maybe those people that work in the clean room, you don't have to go, right? But those people that have never really seen how a clean room looks like, what the machinery is in there, should take advantage of that, okay? The fourth practicum you're going to have is rapid prototyping. So you're going to do 3D printing. You heard a lot about that probably in the news. This is all over nowadays, right? You might have seen The Economist a couple of months ago. There was a Stradivarius, a violin, on the cover of The Economist, and that Stradivarius had been printed. That's a good thing. You might have heard about the bad things. There's people now printing guns, right? So any new technology has good sides and bad sides. But so you will have the opportunity to make a part, and the part you will make there and print, you will design a Bluetooth device. So with the earpiece, right, and the little loop that goes around your ear, and print it out. And finally, you're going to make a compact disc, but not putting music or video on it. You're going to make a compact disc that has chambers, channels, etc., and allows you to do fluidic tests. It's part of a project in my team where we do molecular diagnostics on a compact disc. And so you will learn how to make such a CD. There is some more chairs. There's two more here, so you can put those on the side. So put two there and then put one over here. If you're comfortable enough like that, you guys are young, so it's fine. It's, but it looks like with this kind of audience, if you all guys that are here want to sign up, I will have to ask yet for a bigger classroom. But this must be it, because we cannot further enlarge it, okay? Good, so that's about the practica, and I also told you about the distribution. This will be on the web probably tomorrow. Mitch, can I give a memory stick to you, and can you then put those on the web? Link can help you. Replace the syllabus and the classes from the previous year with those. So now quickly about what's in the syllabus and class one. But I'm gonna cut it short, right, because a big part of you guys already saw it. By the way, you've also seen that these classes are videotaped. And I've been asked if any one of you or videotaped while doing an experiment or so, and you don't want to be shown on YouTube, there's a release form here. Well, we hope you want to be shown on YouTube and sign the forms, okay? So, but since the camera is pointed this way, well, you guys will probably see your faces, so very embarrassing, no? So in any event, we have these forms.
So this one is for, to be on the video?
Yes. Yeah, you could have misinterpreted what I just said. I agree. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to go quickly over class one, but I'm going to have to do it like in 20, 25 minutes, because I want to get to class two, okay? Because that's the schedule. There's a lot of material to cover. Okay. Yeah. That's not funny. Damn. I shouldn't curse in class, right?
Yeah. every time you go to the presentation.
Yeah, it's funny, right? Ah, there we go. Okay. So, we're talking in this class about advanced manufacturing. Recently in the news, you might have heard that the US, especially the Obama administration, for the last couple of years, have started thinking that we have a recession and have so much unemployment and are struggling so much in a way to get the economy back on the road because we lost manufacturing. And so UCI and many other universities in the United States are now doing a concerted effort to re-educate our students in kind of hopefully liking manufacturing, not seeing it as something to be avoided, but something that might be a good job and that might be a good future for you guys. So that's kind of a motivation why you might be here. One of the things we were talking about yesterday is that when you talk about manufacturing, so first of all, a definition, simply speaking, it's about making something and selling it for profit. And in that context, I asked the class a question. I asked the following question: what are the three things that any country on earth needs to do to bring in money? And we talked about, it was mining, manufacturing, and the third one, I asked you guys to go figure it out. I'm not going to tell you, you guys need to figure it out. There's a third one. So what we basically are saying, all of this banking business, all of this kind of virtual, forget it. That really is only getting money from you guys into the banks. It goes from the poorer to the richer often. It's only by creating value, by mining, selling it, or making and a third thing that brings in money into the country. And so you guys have to think about the third one. There was another question. I was asking if anyone had an idea, when you look at this thing, this is a human hair. And I asked about the dimension of this. And so, anyone who wasn't here yesterday, you weren't here, Jack, right? Brouwer, Mr. Brouwer, right? Andrew Brouwer. Yeah, I'm confusing with Professor Jack Brouwer. Are you his son?
Yeah.
Oh, see, wow, I had it right. That's great. So, Andrew, I'm going to keep on saying Jack, I know. You're okay with that, right? So, one of the questions was, how thick is a human hair? He's off by about a factor of 20. About 80 to 100 microns. And you see these holes. Do you think these holes were drilled in there? Were they made mechanically? How do you think they were made? That was the second question. And gradually, as I go through the course, your light bulb will go off. I say, yeah, I know how it's done, right? So is anyone already now kind of thinking on how this might have been done? Yeah? Don't say it yet. Keep it a surprise. Keep it a suspense. Because eventually, later, we will put little statues on a human hair. In the case of cutting these holes, we talk about one form of manufacturing called subtractive. And it's one of the many ways you can categorize manufacturing processes. Another one is according to the kind of energy involved. So you can do manufacturing by applying mechanical energy to a workpiece, such as in cutting and shaping, electrical energy, heat energy, like in laser cutting, or chemical energy such as electrochemical machining. So one way of categorizing advanced manufacturing processes is by considering what kind of energy is applied. Another one is the one I just told you about. So if I cut holes in a human hair, I take something away, right? Subtractive. But if I learn how to put teeny little statues, nanometers in size, on a human hair, I do additive manufacturing. So that's yet another way of categorizing manufacturing. By the way, I also pointed out, this sounds like simple, right? I'm going to say CNC machining, is that subtractive or additive? That's an easy one, right? But we will see that actually, once you talk about additive processes, it's not always so easy to categorize them in one of those four because they often overlap. And we see examples of that. So what do we accomplish? When you're finished with this class, we would like you to be a bit more of a mature person that actually can do the following thing. You will be able to decide, if I give you a product I want you to make, would you make that product by applying mechanical machining or lithography? So mechanical machining would be, let's say, that CNC machining, right? Cutting or sawing or drilling. Whereas lithography is what you do in the integrated circuitry field, what you do in a clean room. And I told you one number as a good cutoff, a good measure, when you would use mechanical machining versus lithography. Do you remember that number? 100 microns. So simple number, keep it in mind. It basically means that if features are becoming smaller than 100 microns, so smaller than a thickness of a human hair, you probably cannot do it with mechanical milling. There's no drills much less than 100 microns in diameter. So you're going to go to lithography. In other words, you're going to machine with light instead of with a mechanical tool. So you're going to learn about that. You're going to learn what type of mechanical machining to use and what type of lithography-based machining to apply. Third point. And the third point actually introduces yet another way of categorizing manufacturing. You're going to decide if you're going to make something with a bottom-up versus a top-down manufacturing technique. Now, what is that? Bottom-up and top-down. Well, through the eons, people have basically manufactured top-down. You know, you took a big piece of rock, cut into smaller pieces, and do something with it. Or you take silicon, a big ball of it, a crystal, cut it into slices, make ICs. So you go from the big to the small. That's top-down. Now, nature does not build that way. Nature builds bottom-up. It goes atom by atom, molecule by molecule, and it goes from the single cell to human being. Right? And it turns out that you guys are born in a lucky period, because the last 15, 20 years, these two fields have started overlapping. In other words, sometimes there's a piece, a device, you can make either way, top-down or bottom-up. You guys are going to be able to decide which method to use. The fourth point gives you yet another technique or another method to distinguish between different manufacturing techniques. Those are called serial, batch, or continuous manufacturing. I will give you examples later, but you already probably get instinctively the idea of what that will mean, right? Serial is if you make one thing at a time, at great cost, expensive, you make one of those and you sell it. It's going to be expensive, right? Batch. An example is integrated circuitry, silicon. You have one silicon wafer, and you might, per wafer, have 800 devices. That's a batch. Now, because you process each of these sensors at the same time, you have a tremendous cost advantage. That is why you have computers that are so inexpensive. Now, there's a push to go beyond that. That push is to do continuous manufacturing. So, in other words, you would produce, perhaps, chips, solar cells, and other items continuous, just like you print a newspaper, right? So these are another method of categorizing manufacturing. So far, how many methods have we listed to categorize manufacturing? One was this energy, another one subtractive versus additive, another one was
top-down, bottom-up.
Top-down, bottom-up, another one was
machining lithography, or
Serial batch,
right? Continuous. And so probably by class two or three, you will have seen like five or six methods that I could give you a technique. I'm going to say EB machining. That could be a midterm question or a final exam question. EB machining, categorize it according to all of these rules. Is that a serial technique? Is it a batch technique? And that will help you decide where you would use it. Five, what rapid prototyping method? Select. We will eventually give you a logical decision tree to sort out the machining options you have. And then we'll give you examples that will include a variety of products ranging in size from nanometers to centimeters. The little movie that's next, because of time, I will not show you, but make a note that you can Google plenty of movies that talk about the size of things. That kind of gives you a feel about when you go from the stars to atoms, how many orders of magnitude you cross. And it's a point I didn't make yesterday, but I'm making it today. If you look at a tree, nature can manufacture things from the nanometer to, let's say, tens of meters. So it literally spans perhaps 20 orders of magnitude in scale, in size. Now, when humans manufacture something, how many orders of magnitude do you think we typically cover? Let's say CNC machining. How many orders of magnitude could we cover? It's embarrassing. Maybe two, three, you're right. Look how, and that's why we are sometimes baffled with how nature is so clever to come up with techniques that we want to mimic. We call that biomimetics. So often in our manufacturing approaches, we will look at nature for guidance. Because if we could have a manufacturing technique that covers much, we call that multi-length scales, it will be much more powerful, right? You might have something that's a couple of centimeters, but it might be patterned with a nano pattern. So that's an important point. So do look at some movies that talk about length scales. You'll find plenty of them. The syllabus. So today in class one, we're going to cover point one and two. And I hope to get to three, so because I wanted to get into class two. Right, so class one talks about sealed batch and continuous, which I already kind of told you what it's about. A little bit more of a sophisticated point that I will drill in and is important is to understand relative tolerances in manufacturing versus absolute tolerances. And we kind of make some surprising statements in that regard. In class two, we will start with one of the energy domains in manufacturing, namely, we're going to talk about mechanical machining. And that's kind of the oldest, more traditional form of making things, right? Maybe starting with hammering something, drilling something. And so mostly that will be fun because we can go through that very fast. But I need to tell you that that actually has developed into very sophisticated manufacturing means. CNC machining today, five-axis CNC machining can achieve nanometer tolerances. Kind of amazing. We can actually do sometimes about the same thing as we do in integrated circuitry. Believe it or not, he can do nanotechnology with CNC machining. So pretty surprising, no? We will then talk about electrical energy-based machining. We will in class five talk about heat energy applied in machining. That will be principally laser machining. And then the fourth category you remember in terms of energy domains is chemical. After that, we will talk about next generation lithography, introduce some nano machining tools, then give one class on top down versus bottom up machining. 10 is this 3D printing. And you will actually get a class by the director of Rapid Tech who's here on campus. He will be the same one who will introduce you to your design problem. And then we'll talk about matching manufacturing process to product specification and design. Remember, that needs to be the outcome, where you are at the end of this class. And then that manufacturing process decision tree. So, class one, definition of manufacturing, sealed batch and continuous manufacturing processes, and then this point about relative tolerances versus absolute machining tolerances. What this cartoon is pointing to is kind of, maybe you can call it the valley of death. You see, UCI and many other places are getting very good at nano and MEMS micromachining in this domain. And other people can do good miniature machining. Microns, millimeters, centimeters. In between here, it's a very difficult domain. There seems to be hardly any machinery that can do that middle range. And so we'll come back to that again in a later class. That's called meso-machining. So miniature machining, meso-machining, silicon micro-machining. For a job, it's always to go there where there's the least expertise. And so this one might be one to look at. I'll give you an example. We can make plenty of MEMS devices, gyroscopes, accelerometers, pressure sensors. But you know where it's often hard is how to package them, to put them in a nice package that interfaces with the world. And that would be meso-machining. Okay, this time not Mitch. This is too much text. I need someone with a strong voice who will read this because I can't do it. I'm too tired. Strong voice. Strong voice. Okay. Loud. Stand up. Say it.
Manufacturing is the use of machines, tools, and labor to make things for use or sale. The term may refer to a range of human activity, from handicraft to high tech. It's most commonly applied to industrial production, in which raw materials are transformed into finished goods on a large scale. Such finished goods may be used for manufacturing other more complex products, such as household appliances or automobiles, or sold to wholesalers, who in turn sell them to retailers, who then sell them to end users.
Did he make it okay? Okay. Thanks to Wikipedia. So, okay, that was easy, no? So now quickly, you already know the concept, and as I told you, I have to hurry a bit because I need to get to class two. One of the ways to categorize manufacturing, not the one up in the energy domains, was in serial, batch, and continuous. So serial, single unit production, or serial production. The primary characteristic then of the next method, batch production, is that a group of identical components are completed at the workstation before they move to the next. In other words, if you make an integrated circuit, you will, for each of the individual transistors that you make in there, apply that oxide all at the same time. That makes it extremely similar from product to product. So you could never achieve that, by the way, with serial methods, because each of them has been made separately. That oxide deposition that I'm referring to as an example goes all at the same time. It's tremendously powerful. And then finally, continuous production is a method used to manufacture, produce or process materials without interruption. Making skis would be?
Serial.
Integrated circuit production, batch. And then laminating wood here in panels, continuous, right? So eventually we want to do this. And by the way, there's quite a bit of activities along that line to do this continuous. Yes?
Is there a limitation why they cannot make like ski lift on continuous or batch manufacturing methods?
You probably could eventually do it, but I think sometimes it's like the Gucci bag phenomenon, certain things you don't want to become too cheap, you know what I'm saying? People, suppose you have a product and everyone has it, you will see someone will actually try to lure rich people into buying something that has a special design and has been made one by one. So I think it's kind of that answer. So now, the only kind of serious point, no, everything was serious, I'm sorry. But think about it a bit more. This is this relative tolerance versus absolute tolerance. And what is the difference? So if I measure this quantity here, it could be millimeters or centimeters, you're going to express it, you're going to express it in terms of what kind of error do you make. So for example, if I specify 1 meter, but it could be plus or minus 1 centimeter, the relative tolerance is 1/100. It's that simple, right? Absolute tolerance is the 1 centimeter, okay? So remember that. Now, I'm going to make an important graph for you. This, forget it for now, this comes back in class two. I will cover that in detail in class two. But what I want you to understand, and it's that was the last thing I covered right yesterday, is this curve. So think this through with me. Forget this axis here. Forget all of this. Just look at this axis, and it shows the size of things. From big things, like a rocket or a temple, to very small things, like 1 micron. And this is relative tolerance. And you see this amazing thing that if you plot this, you'll see a peak. And the peak is around maybe 1 to 10 centimeters, kind of the size of a human hand. That means that today, human manufacturing is the best at a piece of this size because it can be handled, positioned the best, and can be measured the best. If you have a huge thing like a temple, it is very difficult to remain very good in relative tolerance. For example, if you build yourself a house, you probably will be talking about the relative tolerance about 1%. Interestingly enough, that's about the same relative tolerance as you making an integrated circuit that's working in the 100 micron domain. Do you follow that? And it's a very often neglected point. Look, if you think about silicon micromachining, the MEMS people, the nanotechnologists, you know, they would say, are we so superior in machining and making things? It's only half true. It's true that they can make very small things, so absolute size is very small, but the error you make on that is quite significant. In other words, you know, if in the clean room you're attempting to make 100 micron and instead it's 99 or 101, you can say, oh, I did pretty good. But do you know that traditional mechanical machining guys would not even call that precision machining? Because in their book, precision machining starts at 0.01%. And today, some of the best CNC machining reach 10 to the minus 6, one part per million. So that's an important point. So you might actually, if you need very good relative tolerances, be better off using ultra-fine diamond milling, a mechanical machining technique, than lithography. And for a long time, this was actually neglected. The MEMS people would just kind of, because they came mainly from the electrical engineering world, and they didn't know the mechanical engineering terms in terms of how you express tolerances. And when they started talking together, oh, guys, you're actually pretty poor. You know, your micro device is as poor as me building a house. You make kind of the same big errors on it, right? So do remember that. And that means that in some cases, we might want to keep our micro machine somewhat larger to optimize relative tolerances. That's kind of the only difficult point in this class one. Are you getting this to some degree? If not yet, it'll come back. We'll cover that again. This is one graph I didn't show yesterday. It's such an easy one to understand. If I plot cost of a device versus machining, it's rather easy to see that the finer the machining is, the more you add to cost. So we will in a moment learn in class two, there's yet another method to categorize manufacturing. It's in primary manufacturing, secondary and tertiary. What it is now? Is this method fifth or sixth? Fifth, huh? So primary is I make the shape, the mold. I'm gonna cast metal. We're gonna see a video about that in a moment. That's primary, casting or molding. Secondary, you mechanical machine it, you drill it off. Tertiary, you polish it fine. What this curve is saying, the more you go to this tertiary machining, the more cost you add. That makes sense, right? The finer polished it needs to be, the more expensive this part will be. You don't need to remember anything more about this graph than that. And as I told you, this one, which is very important, I will come back to in class two. Any questions about class one before I switch to class two? So in class two, we're actually going to be really going backwards in time. The Egyptians, we're going to run through forest, making fire with mechanical means, etc. So I'm going to show a lot of videos. Don't fall asleep. And I, depending on, how long am I supposed to teach? From 3:30 till? 4:50, okay. So actually I might get a good way through class two. I did that fast, didn't I? Whew. I'm tired already. Was it okay? Yeah. So any questions about this, about class one? You don't have to be ashamed. You don't have to be embarrassed. Even people that are sitting down, you're okay. You can ask questions. All be okay? So I hope this shutting down automatically will not happen again. Oh, it does. And I don't know how to circumvent it. What did I do a moment ago?
You just closed the one that was just
mentioned. I closed this one, yeah? Okay, that's class one still, right? So close that one. We'll try. But good. Okay, back to the Middle Ages. Method number 5 to categorize manufacturing techniques. Primary, secondary, and tertiary manufacturing methods. We're also going to talk about mechanical machining definition. We're going to talk about the recognized categories of mechanical machining. You're going to learn about turning, milling, drilling, and grinding. Even boring. I hope that doesn't get boring. That was a poor joke. CNC machining, precision machining, ultra precision machining, another technology with CNC machining, mechanical machining. And finally, a very interesting concept that's kind of got quite popular. It's called desktop factories, where instead of having these big milling machines, CNC machines, 2 tons, you know, to make a small part like that, why not make a machine that's about this size? You know, that's more in proportion to the objects you're making. Desktop factories became very popular, especially in Japan in the 90s. And so we'll finish class 2 with this desktop factories. But everything is mechanical machining, and that's machining where we apply mechanical energy, right? One of the other methods of categorizing all these many manufacturing techniques. Here are kind of something that falls in line with there's 3 activities that can make a country money. Mining, manufacturing, and, right? This is kind of a confirmation of the same point. Manufacturing dominates world trade. It is the main wealth creating activity of all industrialized nations and many developing nations. A manufacturing industry based on advanced technologies with the capability of competing in world markets can ensure a higher standard of living for an industrial nation. And you have to really think about that. If you lose that, you might lose the middle class. And isn't that really what's happening in the US? So now, back to science. Another way of manufacturing categories or primary manufacturing processes, and that involves casting and molding. In a moment I'll explain there's a bit of a difference between casting and molding. Secondary manufacturing processes constitute the main mechanical removing techniques involving turning, drilling, and milling. And then tertiary is abrasive processes to super finish a workpiece. These are called tertiary manufacturing processes. Casting and molding, overall what they are, what the verb means, it's the act or process of making casts or impressions or of shaping metal or plaster in a mold. The act or the process of pouring molten metal into a mold. Wow, that was easy, no? But we're going to go into a bit more detail and show you some movies that in practice there's actually quite a bit involved. It's not that simple. We talked about casting and molding. What is the difference? In traditional casting processes, the mold is destroyed. You know, it's consumed and is removed often by heat. Whereas in molding, the mold is reused multiple times. And unfortunately, like with many definitions in some textbooks, molding and casting is not differentiated that way. They sometimes use the term equivalently. Now, I'm going to show you a first video. And how we will do this in this class with these videos, you can go look up Google and find one yourself that does the same thing, so you get the idea of the process, right? Because I'm not going to have the videos linked. Although you're videotaping this, this is all going to be on YouTube, so you could check that YouTube and see the video. So the process we will go through, I might run the video once or twice, depending on if you understood it the first time that I'm running it. It's called lost wax casting process. And so, does anyone know actually what it is without me showing it? So it's a primary manufacturing process, right? You're going to make the first shape that has not been CNC machined yet and does have no polish on it yet. So does anyone know what it could be? Yeah?
If you want to make a tube, you just use it like a cylinder of wax, and then you put it around that, and then you melt the wax out, and then you have a tube.
That's partially true. You'll be surprised there's a little bit more to it. Interesting. You'll see the step that he misses in that one. So let's look through the video, and you guys tell me if I need to run it twice
or
not.
Many machine parts are simply sand or machined out of solid metal. But parts with complex shapes or thin walls can't be made that way. They have to be cast using a technique called lost wax process casting. It takes anywhere from a week to a month to manufacture a cast metal part, depending on its complexity. The first step is to inject wax into an aluminum die, which is essentially a mold whose cavity is in the shape of the part. This creates a wax model slightly larger than the finished part will be. They'll use this wax model to make a mold out of a ceramic material. The mold has to be larger than the finished part because metal shrinks as it cools. Once the wax model is ready, they stamp on a code to tell the foundry workers what type of metal to use when they cast the part. Next, using a hot iron, they attach wax components to create what's called a metal delivery system. Channels that will funnel the molten metal into the mold's cavity.
So far you're right, huh? So far it's wax. But now you see you missed one point.
Next, they dip this wax assembly into a ceramic solution called slurry. They do this by hand to prevent imperfections that would cause defects in the casting. To strengthen the slurry, they coat it in a fine zirconium sand, then let it dry.
Why do we need that, you think? Why do we need to go to ceramic, from the wax to ceramic?
Temperature.
Yeah, temperature. It couldn't survive the molten metal, right?
The wax assembly is about 3/10 of an inch thick. This takes 5 days.
Listen how long a process this is, eh?
The wax assembly is ready for what they call the de-wax. Workers place it in a hot steam chamber called an autoclave for 5 to 10 minutes. This melts the wax right out of the shell, creating a ceramic mold whose cavity is in the shape of the part.
Aha! Now we can pour metal in that, right?
Once the mold is dried out, workers can begin to cast the part. First, they put the cold mold into an oven and heat it up for 2 to 3 hours. This prevents the mold from cracking from shock when it comes into contact with molten metal that's close to 2200 degrees Fahrenheit. They pour the metal into the mold's cavity, then let it cool and harden at room temperature. It takes 2 hours for aluminum, 4 to 5 hours for steel. Once the metal is cooled and solidified, they break off the ceramic mold using a vibrating hammer. This takes about 5 minutes. They saw off the metal delivery system.
You know where these come from, right? That extra metal, that's the piping that you needed to pour it in. So now you're going to cut that off because you don't need it, right? So in other words, we went from primary to secondary, and then we're going to polish it. That's going to be tertiary, and you have your metal part.
Specified in the technical drawing. This is called sizing. Steel parts.
Sizing or metrology, you measure how good your tolerance is in your process.
Technicians use a series of tools and presses to measure the part. If it doesn't meet specifications, it's either reworked or simply discarded. They use sophisticated equipment such as this optical comparator to check the angles and radiuses, and this coordinate measuring machine to verify dimensions. Lost wax process casting is used to make metal parts for all types of machines and equipment.
Are you confident that you could reproduce it, how it works? So you were pretty close, right? Except you forgot if I pour a metal in my wax, the wax would go. But so you have the wax and then the ceramic around it, then you get rid of the wax. And then you also get rid of the ceramic. Huh? Shall we do a test? Who could write each of the steps? Remember each of the steps of the process.
Okay.
raise your hand. Yeah, so we start with?
So you start with a just the shape that you want from aluminum.
Uh-huh, good.
You fill that with a hollow bit of wax and you uh-huh. use channels. You melt it down, you connect them together. I forgot the serial number.
Right. Right. And so why do we make this connection? So he's right so far, right? We have now this plastic, this wax, right?
Yeah.
And so you saw the lady was gluing tubes on it.
You're dumping a liquid in there.
Right. So we need to have access and holes, correct? Yeah.
And? Well, and then you coat it in ceramic, uh-huh. melt it down, or you put it in an oven so that the wax melts out of the ceramic.
Right.
Fire the ceramic so that it's at a reasonable temperature, won't shatter, dump the molten metal in there, and then...
Very good. So who knew this before this video? Raise your hand. One. Raise your hand. Kind of. It's amazing, right? Because what percentage of products we have around us are made with this? A lot.
Yeah, it's got to be huge.
Eh? So isn't it good to kind of know how the world around you works, to get some insight? Eh? Virtual is good, but practical is better, I tell you. Learn to make things. So sand casting. I'd like you to just find the video yourself, you know, explaining how sand casting works. Actually, this drawing here shows sand casting. And you've done it on the beach. You've done sand casting, right? Do you do it with dry sand or wet sand? Okay, see, you got it, right? Why do we do it with wet sand instead of dry sand? Keep shape, right? So. A bit more now about the next step. So the first step we said is primary process, right? We have that shape in metal, and then we do some CNC machining, which is secondary, and we do polishing, tertiary. But let's talk a little bit about that mechanical step where you do the mechanical removal. Obviously, it causes some stress in the part you're working with, right? So mechanical removal processes cause stresses. In the part. The process that produces these complex 3D shapes with very good dimensional control and good surface finishes could actually be screwed up by, for example, thermal. If you, let's say, drill very fast, you might cause so much heat that you actually deform the shape of your workpiece. You could also introduce so much stress with the tool that you overcome the yield stress and the part breaks. So obviously these are two things you want to avoid. Huh? So, I forgot to say one point. I'm just reminded of that. Did you see how wasteful and how complex it was to make that metal shape? It's quite involved, right? Takes a lot of time. You will see, once we introduce rapid prototyping, 3D printing, it is amazing how complex shape you can make. You can actually make parts that turn coming out of the machine. So for complexity, 3D printing is very, very, very good. And you could do it perhaps in a day instead of in weeks or months, especially with the latest printing techniques. You see, a lot of the first printing techniques were in plastic, ceramic, etc. But nowadays, we actually use e-beam and laser sintering to even make metal shapes. So you can imagine what a big difference this will mean eventually for manufacturing. Why did I think about it in this context? Because of the word waste. If I do CNC machining, have you seen how much I need to cut away? In the case of 3D printing, we will see you solidify material, you sinter powder to get only where you need it, and the other powder is recycled. Remember that already for once we talk about 3D printing, right?
Yes. In the first step, you still, or in the transition between the first and second steps, you still recycle and melt down the material that you're cutting off.
Yes.
In the larger mills, at least.
Yes.
I mean, we don't in small machine shops,
yeah,
but it's
that's true.
On a grander scale, it's not super wasteful.
Right. But you do not need to remelt anything. The material is immediately available. The powder is still useful as you started the process. But yeah, you're right. So the method is wasteful of material and expensive in terms of labor and capital. Labor is also a very big point. So how well a part made from a given material holds its shape with time and stress is referred to as dimensional stability of the part. So you'll hear that a lot in mechanical machining. And you already know now what are the two dangers for dimensional stability. It's the temperature and it's the stress that you will cause on the part. And so To maximize dimensional stability, the machine design engineer tries to minimize the ratios of applied and residual stress to yield stress, the yield strength of the material. So a good rule of thumb is to keep the static stress below about 10 to 20% of the yield strength. That kind of makes sense, right? If you stay in the 10% away from where the thing actually cracks or breaks, you're safe. Increased heat at the workpiece causes uneven dimensional changes in the part being machined, making it difficult to control its dimensional accuracy and tolerances. Thermal errors are often the dominant type of error in a precision machine, and thermal characteristics such as thermal expansion coefficient and thermal conductivity really need special attention. So you need to look at what material, how fast you can machine it. Okay? Because certain materials, if you machine fast, they cannot conduct the heat away, they melt, and you have not the part you want. This is simple so far, right? But I think it's important that you learn even the basics of how parts are made. We're going from the big to the nano. So in mechanical subtractive machining, this is kind of a repeat. It's a definition. Physical removal, yes?
Where does the original molding piece come when you're casting from? Because it said they started with an aluminum piece. Is that made through mechanical machining?
Yes, right. So that would be going back to, there's several techniques, we will talk about that a lot, that's mold making, right? That can be done with EDM, electro-discharge machining, electrochemical, very fine CNC machining. It's a very good question, and there will actually be one class dedicated to making molds, because in a way, if you make a mold, you only need once the most expensive step, because all of the rest then is a replicate of it. So keep that thought. We will talk specifically in one class how you make molds. It will be in a class called LIGA. And that's making molds for nano devices, but same concept. So second bullet point, mechanical material removal techniques are also categorized as single point machining or abrasive machining, which is also multiple point machining. Do you understand that point? So if I use sandpaper, will that multi-point or single point? Let's see, multi-point, right? So that's abrasive machining. When I use a single diamond as my cutting piece, which we do more and more, that will be single point machining. And it's easy to remember that. This is perhaps one of the first lathes that were pictured anywhere. So this is 300 BC. What does BC mean? What does it mean?
I have no
idea. Oh, come on. I need to get you guys some culture too. Come on. Is it after Christ or before Christ?
It's before.
Oh, good. Thank you. So, what was the dominant culture 300 BC worldwide? That's actually a dangerous question, right? Where were cultures really flourishing worldwide? Middle East?
Egypt.
Egypt, yeah. Where else? What happened in China at that time? What happened in China at that time?
Mongols.
When was that happening? We're engineers, man. I
don't
know history.
No, come on. I want you guys to be modern. You see, you need to know languages. You need to know culture. We have become too one-dimensional. Actually, we should even become politicians because we're being screwed up by the politicians. Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, it is. Anyways. Never make that point again. What? Great Wall? Is that 300 BC? Was it built around that time? I always like to learn, so who will research the dominant cultures 300 BC? Will you? Next class, you'll tell us what kind of cultures were dominant worldwide and what they did manufacturing-wise. What kind of things were they making at that time? We'd be surprised. Huh? So how does this thing work, by the way? What is happening here? Can you kind of figure this out? So this guy is holding a tool, right? And the workpiece that's being machined is this thing, right? And with this cord, he's rotating it. He's doing like that, right? And this will be one of the mechanical machining methods. So you can already probably think it out. Will it be called turning, milling, drilling, or grinding? It will be called will be turning. And so you see that these techniques are still the dominant techniques we use today to make things. And so to drill it in your mind, I have chosen a little movie about each of those. So first, milling. So milling is the use of a rotating multi-point cutting tool to machine flat surfaces, slots, or internal recesses into a workpiece. It's very versatile. So you have a metal piece, you have a tool that lowers itself and then carves out a pad in your workpiece. Turning on the other hand is much more limiting, because in turning you make basically cylindrical objects, because now in this case your tool stands still and your workpiece rotates. That's the big difference between milling and turning. You remember that? And you'll see that when you have the CNC machine in class. So let's look at a little video illustrating both, and you'll tell me which one is which. So this video, tell me if this is milling or turning. By the way, Haas is a company in Irvine making CNC machines. It's pretty noisy, isn't it? So what is it doing? Why is the water there?
It's cooling.
Cooling, right? So is this milling or turning? It's milling, right? Because in this case, the computer will direct the tool. By the way, the computer can even pick the tool. Up to 90 tools, can you imagine? All automatically. Takes this tool, goes to the machine, and then it creates a part. Right? That's what you also will see in practice. So yes, this is milling. Now this one,
it's a roughing technique, which you
want roughing or turning, right?
You start with the tool.
We are going to the wood shop.
Let it go to you. Just start getting, then bring the tool down and pull it back.
So if he does that, what would you make? You could make the legs of a chair or a table, right?
Start getting steam chips come off.
You got that, right? Good.
And make yourself small cuts.
Turning. So the main difference between turning and milling is that in turning the workpiece spins with while the tool remains stationary. Because of this, turning can be used to create, that's very important, eh? So you can create a much better surface finish with turning than you do with milling. Both are done on a machine called lathe, and you saw where maybe the first lathe was depicted here. 300 something, right? Now this one is drilling, and I found a funny movie for drilling because I thought everyone would know what drilling is, but I thought maybe you had forgotten about this application of drilling. So there we go. So what is he going to be doing with his drilling here? I want to hear, yes, that's what he does. What's he doing? He's going to?
Fire,
yeah. And so what music would you place on this? Yeah? So this is? And what is boring? This might be boring. But boring is widening the hole that you've been drilling, right? But at least maybe these little videos will make it such you never have to study this. You will remember what it is, right? Milling, turning,
boring
drilling.
Done on a turning machine, right?
Yeah. Boring is really nothing else than making the hole larger that you drill. So what will he do next? Who has ever done this? One? Boy Scout. Who has ever done this? So what will you do now? Spit on it? Anyways, he made fire, right? You've seen enough, right? We can move on? No? Okay, you want to see the fire, right? He even has a little tent there. His little friend Tonto lives there. Ah, did it, huh? Look at that, look at that. Huh? Anyways, you can find plenty of movies of drilling. Okay, there's also grinding. I'm not sure if I'm even gonna run this little clip, but because it's so good for your memory. So in grinding, what will he be doing? Will he be using multi-point? Single point, multi-point, right? So grinding is a finishing process, and therefore, in terms of cost, where does it fall? You remember? We went from primary, secondary to tertiary. That's tertiary. Much more expensive process, right? Very good.
Is it expensive because of labor costs
labor.
Or material costs?
You will see that even, you know, for a very common product, the final touch is manual in this case. It's so difficult to control because you might have this rounded, strange shape. You know, how will you polish this out? It's labor. So now we're going to translate all of this 19th century kind of stuff and all the way to 300 BC. Where has this evolved into? It has become a lot more sophisticated, we'll see. And the development in a way started around 1977, where people start being able to control XY stages. Now, if you think about it, what you need in any machining process is a table where you can control very precisely the XY position and the Z position. You often, in the beginning, they would do that, you know, give a pulse train to a stepping motor would change the gear, and you would have a work table that moves. But you know, that doesn't have any feedback. So the first improvement that happened was how to check where that work table is, what is its position. So you needed sensors, a position sensor. A position sensor that gives feedback to the computer and controls, yes, indeed. You put your table there, it checked it, is indeed where you think it is. That is such a common thing, this position table. It's common to lithography, mechanical machining, and you will find that that is the underlying reason for this relative tolerance argument. Because you can imagine for building a temple, you cannot make an XY table that's 100 meters long, right? And then, if your item is so small, your table will vibrate, the easiest little fluff of air will mess up your position. In between, something that has this size, it can position it very well and measure very well where it is at. That's kind of why these sizes have optimal relative tolerance. So in the beginning, at the start, the smallest movement these machines could reproducibly make was about 0.5 microns. So, what is 0.5 micron? Human hair again? It's how big?
It's
100 micron. A human cell?
It was
5, 6 microns, right? Dust particle, smallest dust particle. 1 to 2 microns. So in a clean room, you avoid these particles, right? Because there we're gonna be making shapes that are so small that when a dust particle lands on it, it's like a bomb. Right, we're going to make nanometer lines, and there comes a 1 micron smoke particle or a fluff, you know, dandruff from your hair. Wah, it's over. Right. So knowing these sizes and what's important, you get a feel for. The resolution of the steps a machine can make, of course, is a determining factor for the manufacturing accuracy of the workpiece. Numerical control is a method of automatically operating a manufacturing machine based on a code of letters, numbers, and special characters. So there will be one class where you will be taught how you go from a design, translate in a code, feed it to a machine and make a part. That will be the CNC machine in class. So for today, I will go over it fast. I'm just introducing the concept, but it's much better to see it at work, isn't it? These CNC machines, in general, can do two things. It's kind of easy to recognize. One can be point-to-point control. So the tool does something here. It's lifted up, goes somewhere else, does something. Or the tool stays in contact with the workpiece, and that's a continuous machining process. So we have point-to-point control systems, cause the tool to move to a point on the part, execute an operation at that point only. Lift up, go do somewhere else. Maybe it drills all of the holes where the screws go. Or it carves a slot from screw to screw. Right? That would be the continuous part controllers. By the way, in the next two slides, or three slides, I will have a question for you guys, and I'm going to see who paid attention. I'm going to ask you a question. So follow this next two slides carefully. But this shows what? Point to point or? Continuous, right? And so here will come the question. So CNC milling machines, which you're going to see in the lab and see someone operate for you, can perform simultaneous linear motion along the three axes, and these are called three-axis machines. So one of your simplest CNC machines can do this, this, and this. Right? Now the next thing, more sophisticated and more expensive, it can also do this, this, and this. And still, out there, we will never talk about a six-axis machine, only a five-axis machine. Why is that? You're almost, I think you know it. I want you to say it a bit more accurate. Did you understand what he meant? Try it again. Huh? So we have X, Y, Z, and then you have A, B, C, where you rotate around each axis. Along one of these axes, what he's basically saying, nothing else will happen. It will be the same thing. That's what you said, right? So I still see people like, which axis?
Z.
Okay, yeah, you guys got it. That was not too difficult, right? Thank you. So the most sophisticated CNC machines are five-axis machines, right? So they can do X, Y, Z, and they can do A and B. Very good. You guys are paying attention. That's great. This slide will be the beginning slide for that class that introduces you to CNC machining. So it will go from how to develop or obtain the 3D geometric model of the part you want to make using computer-aided design, decide which machining operations and cutter part direction are required, computer-assisted, choose the tooling required, also computer-assisted, run, what is CAM?
Manufacturing
software to generate the CNC part, verify and edit the program, download the program to the proper machine, and make your part. And so you will have one class where on one Monday this will be explained in more detail, and then you will see that person carry it out. We probably will split you in four groups so each of you can hang around this man closely and see what happens. Right? Okay, we are moving on. 1977, what was kind of the dimension tolerances we reached? 0.5 microns, right? So things got better and better. And it was mostly driven by mechanical engineers who wanted to do precision machining. And that's a point I made already, right? Precision machining, they define where the relative accuracy, and what is that again? So it's tolerance divided by the object size, right? I was telling you 1 meter over 1 centimeter would be a relative tolerance of
1%,
right? But look, you have to have 10 to the minus 4 or less for it to even be called precision machining. And you will find that in most of the cases, lithography and MEMS doesn't allow you to do that. It's on that wrong side of the curve. You remember that bell peak, right? That peak is at sizes quite a bit larger than that. So for comparison, and this is kind of repeating the point from at that time, a relative accuracy of 10 to the minus 3 in the construction of a house, that would be a very well built house. Very excellent. Now, it's important to realize that while integrated circuit techniques and silicon micro and nanomachining can achieve excellent absolute tolerances, they can make very, very small things, right? But relative tolerances here are rather poor compared to those achieved by most mechanical machining techniques. I said this three times now, for some of you two times, some of you three times. It's an important point. The decrease in manufacturing accuracy with decreasing size is rarely mentioned in discussions of silicon micro machines. You know, you want some, my thing is the best, right? Nothing can beat it, but it wasn't really true. This is probably because silicon micro machinists originally were mostly electrical engineers rather than mechanical engineers. That's one of the reasons why it's so good to have engineering disciplines working together. You should have seen what kind of micro-machine motors electrical engineers were making. When mechanical engineers looked at it, this will not work, you know, because they had actually no inkling of a mechanical machine. You know, they knew how to make a design and a pattern, but it wouldn't run. It wouldn't make a motor. And that's why this class that we're teaching this year, next year will be called Engineering 165/265. Because we feel it's important for all engineering disciplines to have this kind of basic background. And often you will correct each other. You know, a bioengineer, chemical engineer, mechanical engineer, you all think very differently. And you need machining in very different fields, right? And by the way, bottom-up machining is not dominated by mechanical or electrical engineers. Who do you think dominates the field of bottom-up machining? Bioengineers and chemical engineers. You know, they make nanoparticles out of solution. They grow from the atoms into a nanoparticle. So that is why this field has changed so much, and it's important we mix all of the engineering fields and bring them into this domain. So, 1966. In the 1980s, advanced machine tools became equipped with precision metrology and control tools. So in other words, that position table, the XY table, with more and more precision, they could say where the machine starts cutting, right? Today, we will see an example where literally they can machine in the nanometers, almost like what you achieve with integrated circuit technology. Quite fantastic. It's a machine made in Japan by Fanuc. It's a robotic CNC machine. I will show a picture of it later. So these machines use laser interferometers and capacitance probe feedback controls. You remember, originally, you would have these stages in open loop, right? You would push them, but you wouldn't know where they really were. And I was talking about a sensor to figure out where they are. So these sensors are either capacitive-based or laser interferometry-based. You have to have temperature control. And these stages, by the way, were hydrostatic originally. And nowadays, they're air bearings. Why is that? You want to make them as stable as possible, isolated from a car that passes by, kids coming from school, walking on the floor, your whole piece might be messed up. So what your machine needs to be isolated from the environment. So you need to create more and more stable XY tables. So precision manufacturing at that time started being extended for industrial use, for cutting of aluminum first. Was making for components such as laser scanners, photocopying machines, computer memory disks. That's all not that long ago, isn't it, right? Well, for you guys, it's long ago. So you guys weren't born here, right, 1980? Yeah, some of you were born in 19...
The grad students.
Huh? The grad students were, right? Yeah, right, okay. So also in the 1980s, cutting with very small diamond tools introduced in Japan. And this is kind of something we saw. Whereas the US started putting all of its money in MEMS, nanotechnology, and IC production, countries that have been more traditionally intrigued with manufacturing, proud of engineering, like Germany, Japan, Korea, had continued to invest in manufacturing in any possible way, mechanical as well as lithography. So they were the ones that came up with making small diamond tools with diameters as small as 22 microns. You remember that 100 microns? That's true in average. But if you really want to pay a lot of money and do super fine, ultra fine diamond milling, you use a diamond tool of 22 microns in diameter. This is the man who introduced the word nanotechnology. Isn't that amazing? Nanotechnology is not recent. And he introduced it not in integrated circuitry. He introduced it in mechanical machining. And so this is the guy, Norio Taniguchi. So he coined the term nanotechnology. That word stems from 1974, and it was used to define ultra-precision machining. I will show you in a moment in a graph. And actually, it's a graph you've already seen. This graph here was developed by him. But I need quite a bit of time to explain that graph. So what I will do, I will kind of wrap up the class because I only have another 5 minutes. And I'll restart class 3, which is Monday?
Tuesday.
What? Tuesday. We're only Tuesday? Oh, damn, I'm going great. Thursday. We'll do this and do class 3. Man, you'll be finished by mid of this month. Huh? So let's stop it here and entertain some questions.